À jamais. Let me know when to start. प्रीति मैम, एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस मैम, यू आर ऑडिबल।
ओके, आई थॉट परहैप्स ड्यू टू नेटवर्क इश्यू समथिंग इज हैपनिंग।
यू आर ऑडिबल क्लियरली। लेट अस स्टार्ट नाउ।
थैंक यू सो
आशा मैडम, इज देयर इन डिले?
पूजा, यू कैन स्टार्ट। आई थिंक देयर इज सम प्रॉब्लम विद द वीडियो। सो पूजा मैम,
यस मैम,
या यू प्लीज स्टार्ट, बिकॉज आई थिंक देयर इज सम इशू विद द वीडियो ऑन दैट साइड।
वीडियो ऑफ व्हाट?
सो लेट अस, वीडियो इज नॉट प्लेइंग बिकॉज साउंड इज नॉट कमिंग। या यू प्लीज कंटिन्यू।
ओके, सो शुड आई अनाउंस लैंप लाइटनिंग सेरेमनी और?
या दैट्स बेटर।
ओके मैम, नमस्ते एंड अ गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। आई एम प्रोफेसर पूजा देसाई फ्रॉम इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ भगवान महावीर यूनिवर्सिटी एंड इट्स माय प्रिविलेज टू वेलकम चीफ गेस्ट ऑफ टुडेज वेबिनार श्री हरि बाबू श्रीवास्तव, गेस्ट ऑफ ऑनर मिसेस निधि बंसल, डॉक्टर निर्मल शर्मा ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर ऑफ भगवान महावीर यूनिवर्सिटी, ऑल द पैनलिस्ट एंड ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू अवर टूडेज वेबिनार ऑन डिफेंस रिसर्च एंड डेवलपमेंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन DRDO अपॉर्चुनिटीज एंड चैलेंजेस। दिस इज अवर सेवेंथ वेबिनार ऑर्गेनाइज बाय भगवान महावीर ट्रेनिंग एंड प्लेसमेंट सेल टीम एज अ पार्ट ऑफ इंडस्ट्री वाइज CEO एक्सपर्ट्स एंड HR टॉक वेबिनार सीरीज। To make this morning a blessed one, invoke Goddess Saraswati by lighting the lamp of knowledge and wisdom. Light is a symbol of brightness and prosperity. As the sunlight expels the darkness, similarly, blessings bring in our life prosperity and happiness. Deepa Jyoti Param Jyoti, Deepa Jyoti Janardanaha, दीपो हरतु मे पापम दीप ज्योति नमोस्तुते। लेट्स स्टार्ट टुडेज वेबिनार विथ वर्चुअल लैंप लाइटनिंग सेरेमनी एंड प्रेयर। मे वी हैव द वर्चुअल लैंप लाइटनिंग सेरेमनी? शुभम करोति कल्याणम आरोग्यम धन संपदा शत्रु बुद्धि विनाशाय दीप ज्योति नमोस्तुते। या देवी सर्वभूतेषु विद्या रूपेण संस्थिता नमस्तस्ये 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 नमो नमः। Before we begin, few instructions for the participants. We request all of you to kindly keep your videos off and mute yourself during the webinar. The session will of 1 hour and 30 minutes in total, followed by question answer session for around 10 minutes after lecture session. Requesting all the audience to ask their question in question and answer section of this app. We will try to cover all the questions as per the availability of time. Now, taking the program further, let me introduce our audience to our Honorable Provost, Dr. Nirmal Sharma. Dr. Sharma is a competent professional with over 40 years of cross-functional experience including 20 years with the Indian Air Force, 2 years with the software company, 19 years in academics, in higher education. He was attached to Ministry of Defense for 6 years for design, development, installation, and operation of radar and communication project, satellite navigation system with air defense ground environmental system under Radar and Communication Project Office, New Delhi. He has an expertise in microwave, radar technology, fiber optics, satellite communication, along with aerial navigation system, instrument landing system, including differential GPS. He has also expertise in business analytics, management information system, big data, data analytics, and university management system. Sir is also a Kargil veteran and was involved actively in the operation at different locations during that period. I would like to request Dr. Nirmal Sharma, sir, Honorable Provost of Bhagwan Mahavir University, to deliver a welcome address. Sir, please.
Yeah, thank you, Pooja. Good morning and namaste to all. It's indeed a pleasure to be with the DRDO people, the great scientists. We are having a series of webinars for the students from all the fields so that the students should be aware of what is happening around us, especially in India, how the scientists are working, where are the places they can join, what are things going on as far as ISRO and DRDO is concerned. We had a webinar a few days back with ISRO scientists, and they have given good ideas and concepts, and they have narrated the positions where the students can apply and get the job. It's not only to get the job, but we want the university, we want that the students should know what are the places, what are the venues where they can go and join, and what are the places and the things which they can do so that they can plan before they pass out from here. Respected Shri Haribabu Srivastava sir, our chief guest and keynote speaker of today's webinar, Mrs. Nidhi Bansal ji, guest of honor and today's second speaker, all the directors, principals, faculty members, students, and the prospective students, those who have joined to know about the university and about the DRDO. We as an university, we are striving for the students. We are working for the students, for the society. Although we have started this university in 2019, we are so young as an university, but we have an experience as a group of institutions since 2002. 2002 onwards, we are working as a group of institutions. Almost 19 colleges were there, and now we are university. We are functioning as an autonomous body, as an university since 2019. So we have an opportunity to design and define the syllabus and project to the students. It was found that the students, those who are passing out from here, they are not at par with the industry requirement. And even if they are at an industry requirement, they do not know what are the venues they can go and join, what they should do after passing out. So thinking of all these things, we have arranged a series of webinars whereby the top companies, including ISRO and DRDO, we have invited the scientists to let the students know what are the prospects are there, what they are doing, what they need to plan as far as the engineering studies and other studies are concerned. So the prospects are for all the students in all the fields, but they are not aware of the things. During this pandemic, of course, we could not go for offline classes or regular classes, but we have gone for the online classes, although we have completed all the syllabus. and exams online are going on. So we are working on that one, and we don't want the students should miss the syllabus and curriculum. But still, we expect in the coming days the students should come to the college and learn the things practically. We are having our own board of studies where we can design and define the portion in the syllabus, what is to be studied and how far the practical and theory portion should be included. We as an university, we would like the, and as the situation is changing, industrial situation is changing very fast, we need to know what is happening in and around us as far as the technology is concerned. So the syllabus has been defined in such a way with the help of industry people from the industry. Even 60-40 ratio we have kept, and we are inviting the industry people to design our syllabus even. So when they have the experience in the industry and they design the syllabus, it is at par with our requirement to project the things for the students so that when they go out from the university, they should not struggle. It's not only the job we are working or we are focusing on, but we are working and focusing on skill development equally. Degree is one thing. Yes, they will get it. They will study the things. They will get it at par with the industry requirement. But then it's easy for them to take degree and join some organization. But do they have skill to survive in the organization? And that's what we are focusing on. So we are focusing equally on skill development on two to three fold. First is a soft skill development, and that is a must. And we are trying to include on in our syllabus also. And we do have skill development courses approved by UGC and NSQDF. We are going for skill development courses separately for the students. The soft skill is required. And technical skill, yes. Technical skills, when they study here, the practical things are being done, and when they go for the training in the industry or in an organization, yes, they learn the practical things. But when they pass out, they need to be finished. We call it as a finishing school. We want that the students, if they are learning the things, they have the skill development, technical or soft skill, but then they need to be finished at par with the industry requirement. Why we are doing so? Because when we had a meeting with the industries, they have asked us, we have to spend, the industry has to spend on refreshing their skills, and it costs to the company. But then if the universities are taking up these challenges to promote the things as far as skill development is concerned, besides the degree, it will be easy for the industries to adopt them and put them on the job right away. And that concept we have taken up, and we are progressing. Our board of studies are working on that one. Academic Council is working on that one to check into all those things. Even not only soft skill and technical skill, our people are working on for the students and the research skill as well as education skill, which is most importantly required in the society to survive. But then these things are not being included earlier and by many universities, but we are focusing on these four things, and we want that the students should be placed in the society and industry equally. Not only for the job, we are working, the university is working for the entrepreneurship development also. We have tied up with the CED and EDI. Of course, we are going to tie up with the EDI. We are working on that one so that the students, those who are not willing to join a job, they want to do or they want to have their own business enterprise. We are taking care of them also, and we are trying to give them knowledge how to set up the industry. So on these multifold, we are working for the students to get a better livelihood when they join, when they go out from the university, when they pass out from the university. So they should not be missed. And this is being our university as a social responsibility. We are working on that one, and in coming days, we'll be seeing the result. Last year, we had this job fair, grant job fair, where We had, of course, last year it was a total lockdown, so we have gone for virtual job fair. And we had the companies from Kashmir to Kerala, and from, say, Rajkot, Nalia to Assam. All the companies were there for Pan India. The students have registered, 7,400 students registered, and about 1,500 all over India. They have appeared and they were placed. We were not able to conduct this type of grand job fair earlier because of the physical presence. Just 2 minutes. When we have gone for this virtual mega job fair, then we could see that all the people from all over India, they could join, and the placement was very good. And this year also we are trying to get the things done. Let's see how far we can go ahead. But although we are trying the multifold with the multi-system education system, as far as the NEP is concerned, we are working on that one also, and the new education policy of 2020 will be implementing very shortly, and let's see how far we can go up. Although we have 10,000 plus students here, and of course 60 plus programs, so it's a huge one. We are trying to induct some other courses also, so that the students from different field can study here, and then whatever they want, they can study here. Other than medical, we have everything, so they can study here and get their livelihood in the right place. On this occasion of Industry-Wise CEO Experts and HR Talk webinar series on DRDO opportunities and challenges, I have the pleasure to welcome our chief guest and guest of honor, Shri Haribabu Srivastavji and Mrs. Nidhi Bansalji. Thank you for joining us, sir, and we'll be having a good time with you. Our students will listen you, and they will be getting, they will be benefited out of it. Thank you very much once again. Thank you all. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir, for your welcome address. Your thought-provoking address has set a perfect platform to start this webinar. Thank you once again. Moving ahead, let me introduce you all to Shri Haribabu Srivastav, chief guest and keynote speaker of today's webinar, an outstanding scientist and Director General, Technology Management. Prior to taking over as DG in May 2021, Shri Haribabu Srivastav was Director of Laser Science and Technology Center, Met Calfe House, New Delhi, where he was spearheading various technology and product development initiatives in the area of high power laser source, laser spectroscopy, and laser countermeasures. He was Director of Electronics and Computer Science at DRDO during 2013 to 2014. And supported various ECS cluster labs in techno management system of their projects and activities. Sir has started his career in DRDO at Instruments Research and Development Establishment, Dehradun, as a scientist in August 1984. Sir was appointed head of Servo System Division of IRDE on 1st April 2000. Upgraded to this position of Chief Designer of Fire Control System Design Center on 1st January 2008 and rose to the position of Group Director of the Fire Control Systems on July 2012. Sir has shouldered major responsibilities of developing hardware, software, and extensive work on integrating, interfacing, and field evaluation of these systems in various platforms in Indian deserts and naval travel areas. An alumni of IIT Roorkee and IIT Kanpur, Sir has authored and co-authored many technical papers in various national and international referred journals and seminar, conferencing, and a part of these numerous internal DRDO reports. Sir has also co-edited a monograph on night vision and electro-optics technology review. He is a life member of Optical Society of India, OSI, and Instrument Society of India, ISOI. Now, I would like to request sir to enlighten us by your valuable speech. Sir, please.
Thank you, Pooja. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Professor Nirmal Sharma, this is Asha Ramnarayan, Dr. Yadav, Dr. Joshi, Dr. Goel, Dr. Didania, and all the faculty members, students, all those who are present in the webinar, including, I'm told, some of the industry members may also be there. Can you see the screen now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So all those who are present, very good morning to all of you. And in next about an hour, about 30, 35 minutes from my side and from my colleague, Mrs. Nidhi Bansal, we will try to expose to you the outreach that we do to the academia and to the industry. And of course, there was some information to me that I should also cover what all we do in DRDO, how do we identify problems, and what kind of opportunities that students may have or the entrepreneurs may have to do work in the area of defense research and defense manufacturing. So I have put across to you a few points for you to take away, and maybe if there are some questions, we can tackle them at the end of the presentation. So, if you come to Delhi, in the center of Delhi, very close to Rashtrapati Bhavan, we have a modern temple of defense science and technology, defense research, which is what you see on the screen today. Why I put this is because this has got a very special place in the defense science in the country. All the kind of defense science that is being worked in the country is being promoted from this temple of science. I don't know whether you can see my mail ID, if some of you can have questions and all, maybe which we are not able to pick up here. You can mail them and we will be very happy to respond to you. If it is visible, it's okay. Otherwise, it is dgtm@hqr.drdo.in. Changing. Yeah. So as you enter this temple, on the walls, you see kind of wars that were fought in the previous years, hundreds and thousands of previous years. Maybe you cannot see all the details here. So for your benefit, I am putting the next slide. From the Stone Age to the nuclear holocaust, somewhere around 1945, various types of wars were fought. And we have many of these things available in the literature, in history. And if you look at all these photographs that I have put across to you, in the Stone Age, what we see is fighting with stones, as the age says, and with maybe some lathis and things like that, some very, very minimal kind of weapons that were available. But when you look at the epic battles, that is the battle of Ram and Ravan or Mahabharata, you see a lot of good chariots, the missiles, and all those kind of weapons available, weapons and weapon platforms being available. Literature also talks about various kind of aircraft being available and what today we call metamaterials, that kind of activity also happening and projections happening. Maybe we will talk a little later about all that. So to say, from stories to epic battles, the science progressed, and therefore there was some history which says that there was defense research in the previous years in those ages, from Stone Age to epic battles. The most recent battle, which we all Indians love to call as one of the finest battles, was Ashoka's Kalinga War. Primarily not because Ashoka defeated somebody, it is not primarily for that, it is of course the science won, there is no doubt in that. but also the science led to peace. So as our former president Dr. Abdul Kalam used to say, the peace comes from strength. Unless you have strong forces, strong defenses, and unless the enemy is looking at you with awe, the peace will not come. So therefore, it is very important that we have good science, good technology, good weapon systems, and therefore that will bring peace. So that is the Kalinga War. That is what gave us this message. But somewhere in between, maybe in last 4,000 years or 500 years, we lost touch with the science. And in World War One and Two, if you see the other countries, that is the Western countries, Europeans, Americans, they had some technology which was relevant at that time. You see some tanks here, being the war being fought with tanks and some aircraft that Germans had, and bombers the Allied had, forces had. But if you look at our side, at India, in our country, we did not have anything. We sent our people to fight with their bodies and maybe some guns and all given bay pictures. So we did not have any kind of remaining science. Some of you might also recall that Chola dynasty, etc., etc., they had very strong navy and they were having a lot of trade, of course, and then they were controlling a lot of other Eastern Asian countries as well. So we had a very strong the tradition in our country of having missile technology, which is your Ramayana or Mahabharata Kaal mein bolte hain teer aur dhanush chalate the, they were primarily missiles probably, and also the ship technology, that is the naval technology. We had very strong base in our country in the previous years, in the historical time. But of course, in between somewhere we lost touch with the science. Anyway, that is what it is. So when the country became independent, afterwards, around 1960, our leaders, our forefathers, they thought that we should have again good science of science and technology of defense. And therefore, they set up Defense Research and Development Organization in 1960 with the aim, with the vision to empower the nation with these state-of-art indigenous defense technologies and systems. The idea is that we should fight our war with our technology. That is the idea. And how we can achieve that? We can achieve that by designing, developing, manufacturing all state-of-art sensors to see where the enemy is, what enemy is doing or likely to do, and making the weapon systems or weapon platforms and other remaining allied equipment for our defense forces, and which will provide technological edge to our services. And of course, if we have to do that, we have to have good manpower available with the country. And therefore, the infrastructure and quality manpower development also is one of our charters. For those of you who don't know much about DRDO, I just want to give you a glimpse of where do we fit in the government. On top of it, you see MOD, Ministry of Defense, Raksha Mantralay. Raksha Mantralay, primarily, there are four departments that you see here. And to aid and advise the Minister of Defense, our Raksha Mantri ji, Defense Finance, a department. So the four major departments are Department of Defense R&D, DDR&D, Department of Defense Production, that is DDP, Department of Military Affairs, and Department of Defense. Hum log DRDO wale jo log hai, wo we come under DDR&D. And DDR&D primarily, if you look at DRDO, is the main organization which provides science and technology for defense research and development, as the name says. So science and technology for all defense platforms, weapon systems, sensors, etc., etc., is developed in DRDO, and that is being produced by various organizations of DDP, that is Department of Defense Production, or private industry which is in the defense area. And we have some very specific activity doing organizations like ADA, ADA, Aeronautical Development Agency, which is primarily project management agency for aircraft, and also ATVP for submarines. Now, technology jo DRDO mein hum log develop kar rahe hain, and if you look at the war scenario, which I will cover a little later, there are many types of technologies that need to be developed. and taken to the finest level that is possible as per the current science. So this cannot happen if we work haphazardly. This can happen only if there is an effort which is synergized. And for doing that synergized effort to make all the technologies available, we've got our laboratories organized in 8 technology clusters. In fact, we got about 50 laboratories, and in addition to these 50 laboratories, we've got various production centers, which are very specific production centers to do the to support the laboratories. So we have organized them in 8 technical clusters. And what are these clusters? I will tell you a little more in detail later. And we've got 5 corporate clusters. So I will give you a little more details in the subsequent slides. But again, coming back to the kind of war that we have, and because from here the technologies will flow, you see how the technology of war has progressed in the years from 5000 BC to now, and what is the kind of current trend towards 2050 and beyond. So today what we require is day-night all-weather operation. In Mahabharata or Ramayana, jab humne TV mein dekha, to we used to see that raat mein ladai nahi karte the. But today, the war is full 24/7, and also maybe whatever time the war continues. So every time is the war time. There is no night concept, there is no day concept, there is no weather concept that it will not happen in winter or it will not happen in summer. Anytime war can happen, and we should be prepared for that. Now, weapons are traveling at the speed which is beyond imagination, supersonic, 6 times, 7 times the speed of sound, and sometimes even 20 times people are talking. The speed of sound. So that is the kind of the weapon is closing in, and then we need to take proper measures to defend our country. Then autonomous systems, that is fire and forget. You fire the weapon, you fire the projectile, and after that projectile itself will find its own target and go and destroy that target. So that kind of systems are available today. Speed of light engagement. पहले मैंने बोला कि हाइपरसोनिक सुपरसोनिक स्पीड, देयर आर सम वेपन्स व्हिच आर एक्चुअली डूइंग दिस एंगेजमेंट एट द स्पीड ऑफ लाइट, द लेजर वेपन्स. सो यू जस्ट प्रेस द बटन हियर एंड इमीडिएटली द एक्शन हैपेंस एट द अदर एंड. आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस, सो वेयर एवर द ह्यूमन इंटेलिजेंस इज नॉट पॉसिबल एट द रिमोट लोकेशन, ऑटोनोमस डिसीजंस टू बी टेकन. सो वी नीड टू हैव आवर वेपन सिस्टम्स टू बी इक्विप्ड विद artificial intelligence. It should be able to say that this is the proper target, military target or enemy target, this is to be attacked, and another target sideway is not the correct target and not to be attacked. So like that, decisions it should be able to take. Cyber security is another important area, because everything is today working on network, and if the network can be proliferated, then we have big problem. Our systems may not work, or our data may go to the adversary, and those kind of things may happen. So this is a very, very important area in the current times. Very closely related to that is secure data transmission. So unless we are able to send the data either to our forces, or we are able to tap the data from the enemy sources, if we can do that with reliability, then we can win the war. Intelligence through long-range sensors. We may not be able to send our people there, but our sensors should be enabled to see what is happening on the other side. And as longer range as possible, that much is better. And stealth. We should not be detected. Our system should not be detected by the enemy. Of course, we should be able to detect the enemy sensors, enemy systems, enemy weapons. But our own systems, weapons should be protected. The radars of the enemy should not be able to see our equipment. These are the kind of challenges that we have today. And in addition to these challenges, if you see on the right side, we have some more challenges written here, bio threats. We are already seeing the threat that biological warfare agent can have, the corona that we have. Okay? And like that, there could be so many biological threats that may pose a problem to our forces. Similarly, chemical threats. The chemicals may be spread in the air, and that can create so many problems to the troops. And like that, every day new threats are emerging, and we need to constantly look at the threat scenario and keep updating our arsenal. You already know these three forces we have, air, sea and land, and now the cyberspace is becoming another forte to be defended. Space is becoming another, and we have a big problem of asymmetric. Asymmetric, bolne se, it is not army to army fight. It is non-army actors or non-air force actors or non-state actors entering in our territory and then creating a situation what happened in Bombay and what happened 2 days back in Jammu. Like that, those are the things that are asymmetric. So we need to be careful. We need to have technologies that can defend our motherland from those kind of threats. Similarly, cognitive and deep underwater. The underwater threat is even larger because what is happening is submarines may be going around the globe. And if we are not able to detect, they may be able to do a lot of bad things to our navy in our waters of interest. So we need to be, in fact, multifaceted now from air, sea and land. We need to graduate to space, cyberspace, and asymmetric, cognitive, deep underwater, and so many new technologies required. We need to have robotic systems where man cannot go. We should be able to send robot and do the job that we want, directed energy systems, cyber warfare, things like that. So now, how do we do in DRDO? So we, as I told earlier, there are 8 technology clusters, and one of the very important clusters that we have, in fact, all of them are important. So I'll go one by one. We have a missile and strategic systems cluster, which develops state-of-the-art missiles and strategic systems for deterrence and defense. You are already aware of so many missiles that we have in our inventory, like Prithvi, Akash, Nag, Agni, etc., etc. And the pride for the country is our ASAT, anti-satellite missile. You are all aware that a low orbiting satellite was destroyed by this missile. And 2 days back, again, we had a launch of Agni Prime. So this is a very, very good example of how the technology can be taken forward and we can become the world leader. Today, we can very proudly say that whatever kind of missile required by our forces can be developed by our country. Right? Can be developed and produced by our country. So we've got full Atmanirbharta in this technology. And how have we achieved this is by doing a lot of research in aerodynamics, propulsion, navigation, guidance and control, homing systems, warheads, and you name any technology, all of this is indigenous. Nothing is, no technology is imported. Everything has been designed, developed, mastered in our country. And that is why whatever kind of missile required by the forces can be developed by DRDO and can be produced by our factories like BDL. The frontier technology research area in this particular cluster is hypersonic systems. And you are already aware that hypersonic technology demonstration vehicle has already been launched and successfully demonstrated this technology. How this is being taken forward to the state of art, wherever it is required. So if you look at the whole scenario, we are one of the few countries, 3-4 countries who can do this kind of activity, the kind of missiles that we have developed and the kind of missiles, the hypersonic systems of, that we are developing. Very closely related to this is another cluster called BrahMos. And this is actually not a, in strict sense, it is not a cluster, it is a joint venture. It is a joint venture between DRDO and a Russian company where we produce, we develop and produce. The manufacturing also happens in this supersonic missiles. And those supersonic missiles are for air-to-air, air-to-ground, ground-to-air, ship-to-air, ship-to-surface, whatever you name it, for all kind of applications. This missile is available, and of course the technology support comes from DRDO in this, the missile cluster, the MSS cluster, which I said, I told a couple of minutes ago. And all the other technologies like supersonic and the production that happens in the BrahMos system. So we are again Atmanirbhar in this supersonic missile technology. And in fact, you may also be, some of you may be aware that there is a lot of demand for export for this particular missile. So again, this is all subject to government clearance and also this may happen. The next cluster is aeronautical systems. In this cluster, we develop unmanned air vehicles and gas turbine engines, surveillance platforms, parachutes, and things like that. LCA, AEW&C, ALH, heavy drop system, these are some of the success stories, combat free fall parachutes, and there are so many platforms, I could not name all of them here. But you are all aware about LCA Tejas, it comes very regularly in news items. Air Force has already ordered. Similarly, AWACS, AEW&C is also a very important platform which can look hundreds of kilometers into the enemy territory. And heavy drop systems are also important for cases like what is happening on the northern frontier, the frontier which is in China. If we need to drop our tanks, this is the equipment that comes in play, heavy drop system. You can actually lift the tank and you can drop with the help of parachutes. It comes and lands very softly and you can straight away start using the tank. Another important function is about the military airworthiness of platforms and systems. So no equipment can fly unless it is proved for airworthiness. And we are talking of only military airworthiness. We are not talking about civil aircraft and civil air systems. We do all that activity here. Gas turbine for fighter aircraft is the very, very advanced technology. And that is where this cluster is actually doing a lot of work. And hopefully we'll have our own indigenous engine for fighter aircrafts very soon. We are also very proud to tell you that this cluster is also contributing to human and space program of ISRO. The next is naval systems and materials. So a lot of underwater sensors, weapons, and platforms are developed by this particular cluster. And many technologies related to protection of these platforms, or attacking the enemy platforms, or the materials used in that, or camouflaging, all that is being done by this cluster. And the country is actually today Atmanirbhar in the areas of sonars and torpedoes. All kinds of sonars are indigenous today in our inventory. Torpedoes are indigenous in our inventory. And the Navy is working very, very closely with this cluster to see that all Indian products get introduced into the services and they are produced by our factories. Some of the success stories, many types of sonars, I said, torpedoes, bulletproof jacket, ballistic anti-mine boots, high nitrogen steel, and so many other things there. The most important technology today where the country is lacking is materials technology. Most of the good materials is being imported, and that is where this particular cluster is doing human service, and they have developed many new materials and alloys which are being used in naval systems and aero systems and land systems, and many more are there in the research arena at the moment. Coming to the land systems, this is the cluster that works for land systems, armament and combat engineering. They make explosives, landmines, high energy materials, bridging systems, launchers, tracked vehicles, battle tanks, AFBs. So they do that development. And some of the success stories today we have, and we are the only country to have developed a towed artillery gun with the largest possible range in the world. There is no other country which has matched this particular capability. MBT Arjun is another success story. 120, 125 millimeter FSAPDS and other ammunition. Pinaka was in news a few days ago. 120 millimeter, 122 millimeter Pinaka was fired a few days ago with success. Modular bridges, corner shot weapons, so many weapon systems have come out of this particular cluster. And as the time progresses, today if we are able to fire at 2 kilometers, tomorrow our adversary we want to defeat at 2.5 kilometers, after 3 kilometers. So this research continues. We continue to work for more lethal weapons, more agile weapons, and for 24/7 engagement. So all these platforms which I said so far, they are enabled by sensors, and this particular cluster called electronics and communication systems provides those sensors. So electronic warfare systems, radar, electro-optical systems, fire control systems, thermal imaging, surveillance systems, lasers, directed energy systems, LIDAR, so many kind of activities happen. Any kind, and this is the cluster that actually utilizes the spectrum, the electromagnetic spectrum, maximum. So all the kind of frequencies are being utilized by this particular cluster to provide the intelligence to these other platforms. The platforms being developed by other clusters. So whether it is microwave or optical or infrared or ultraviolet, all those kind of spectrums or millimeter, those are being utilized by this particular cluster. Again, the country is Atmanirbhar in EW systems, electronic warfare systems, radars and electro-optical systems. Some of the success stories, many types of radars have been produced and they are introduced in these services. Night vision devices, all the night vision devices that you see with the armed forces, police forces, they are of our Indian origin, our Indian design from this cluster. And the thermal images, of course, not all, but many thermal images are from this particular cluster. Air control systems on tanks, aerial platforms, radios for communication, those are all coming out of this cluster. Now, the frontier technology research areas in this cluster are lasers, signal processing, transceivers, conformal integrated antenna, and micro and nano optics, optical coatings. These are some of the research areas that this particular cluster is now engaged in. And again, to support the electronics cluster, we have another cluster called microelectronics, electronic devices, computational systems, and cybersecurity. So the kind of devices that are used for sensing, kind of devices used in, let us say, the radars or the electro-optics or the lasers, those devices this particular cluster is supposed to develop. And they are engaged in developing solid-state devices like laser diodes, infrared FPS, focal plane arrays, gallium arsenide and gallium nitride devices, artificial intelligence, robotics, and so on and so forth. So this is ever-evolving technology. It is very difficult to say that we have become Atmanirbhar today, because today you develop something, day after tomorrow or tomorrow, you have another technology coming in. And therefore, it is always this particular cluster will keep on engaging in the frontier research. Some success stories, they have developed hydrophones, e-Nasika for sensing the explosives, GIS, our own Indian GIS for military, artificial artillery combat command and control systems, and many more platforms for different applications in the Navy, Air Force, and the Army. Today, the most important area for research is high-power laser diodes, quantum communication, and terahertz. And this particular cluster with two or three labs, very dedicatedly working for these particular activities. And unless there is a man to do all this to fight the war, how much amount of artificial intelligence you can put in these systems, but unless there is a man behind the machine, nothing will work. So this is a cluster that actually provides all the support to people behind the army men or the air force men or the airmen or the naval people. And it develops tools and processes and systems for psychological, physiological, and nutritional well-being of soldiers in areas high altitude, in deserts, all the kind of areas wherever normal human being doesn't want to operate, our forces have to operate, and therefore they must get the technological support to operate in that area and if it be needed. So this is the cluster that provides that support. The chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear tech is a reality today. People are already talking that corona is actually an attack, biological attack. And therefore, you would have seen cluster has risen to the occasion. And during the corona time last year, as well as this year, we have done so much of work for the country. And of course, there's nothing to boast about it. It is only what country has given to us. We are trying to pay back to the country. The kind of detection, the detection technologies, management technologies, and what more we can do to defeat that technology. So some of the success stories, all of you would have heard the medicine called 2DG that has been developed by this cluster. Probably it is the only kind of medicine in the world. Nobody else has done so far. Oxygen generation plants, so many we have developed and placed at different locations. PM Care Fund is supporting this activity. High altitude agriculture in areas like Leh and Don, for them to sustain in the winter time, we need to have local production of the fruits, vegetables. So that this particular cluster has actually worked out the technologies for high altitude agriculture, high energy food. If they are not, the fruits are not able to get the food, then and they need to sustain themselves. So with few bites, they get full energy and then they're able to sustain. So that kind of food cluster has developed CVR and equipment, life support systems for aircraft, etc. Chemical biological threat is the current focus of this cluster. How to detect the threat when it is not very close to us, and how to neutralize that threat. So these are the activities that this particular cluster is actually engaged in at this point of time. So I have spoken about what all kind of achievements in different clusters, but these are some of the glimpses. What you see, this is the ASAT anti-satellite missile, and we are probably the number 3 in the world to have done this, third country to have done this. Various types of missiles, other missiles, and today if you look at Agni 5, we are able to cover half of the globe. Half of the globe can be covered, so that from wherever the threat is originating, the country is sufficiently having the strength, the muscle to actually neutralize that threat, and also do what more is required to be done. Akash is already with Air Force and Army, Prithvi, and so many other things. There's no time to get into more details about the technology, but if you look at the technological spectrum that all these missiles have, or any of these platforms have, this is immense. And all those have been actually mastered by DRDO. And of course, many of them have been transferred to industry, Indian industry, for producing. Other weapon platforms, AWNC, Arjun, and Himshakti, that is the electronic warfare systems, and many other systems. These are the mines, a different type of equipment that's possible to do. Robotic equipment here. And again, in areas where ambulance, the four-wheelers cannot go, two-wheelers can go. So we have developed an ambulance on two-wheeler. One of our labs called INMAS has developed that. So this can be the basic requirement for the patients can be transported by this ambulance, two-wheeler ambulance, and then go there. 2DG, like that, there are so many things which probably we not be able to talk in more details. One of the important activities done in the country and still being done in the country is the hospitals. We have been able to create hospitals of 500 beds or more within, let's say, a week or 10 days or 15 days time, depending on the location and depending on the number of beds that are required. All ICU beds, ventilators is another technology that was pioneered by DRDO. And today, all the ventilators that are produced in the country, or all the PPE kits produced in the country, they have all been certified by DRDO. Now, coming to the outreach, this is what I told what we do in DRDO, but now coming to the outreach to other organizations. So we have the DGs actually looking into specialized areas. For coordination with services and also with production agencies, we have a director general called DGPC and SI. And any coordination with foreign countries, joint ventures, etc., is also looked after by him. We have a resources and management DG who looks after the resources and management part of the organization. And for HR policies, we have director general. Coming to what is required for doing with academia and industry is the director general technology management. Now, this industry is not big industry. Here I'm talking of the small industry and the startups. So we do the assessment of threats. We worked out what are the upcoming technologies and what could be their effects on war mechanisms. This is what we do, and we have a directorate under DG Technology Management called Directorate of Systems and Technology Analysis. So from there, here the flow starts. So if we know what are the threats, what are the kind of technologies are being developed by other countries, and where the science is going, even though somebody may not be developing the weapon based on that science, but at least if we know what is the kind of science flow happening in the world, we can work out whether this particular science is good for making a weapon or whether our country requires that kind of weapon. So if we do that, then we can feed to different clusters to work on those technologies and make the weapon systems or the sensors. The another directorate or a couple of directorates, they do coordination with academia for directed research, extramural research, and manpower development. So we have a directorate called Directorate of Futuristic Technology Management. And this directorate has established many advanced technology centers in academic institutions. One is there in Gujarat as well, in the Gujarat University. And we are spread all across the country. Today, there are 9 centers in working in different specialized areas required for DRD. So this is directed research. What we require, we request the university to work on, the IITs to work on. And we work together, our scientists and the faculty and the PhD scholars, they work together, they bring out new advances in the science and the technology, and that is taken care by the laboratories to make the equipment. But this is not all. We have another set of 4 research boards and 1 directorate of extramural research, where what university thinks or what the researchers think in the country, where they can take the science. So that also we fund. And these actually we are spread all across the country. I think more than 200 institutions we have funded, and we have been funding for a long time. And some of these technologies, they could be from technology readiness level 1, they might have brought it to 3, or from just concept to demonstration level, they might have brought. I will tell in detail what is TRL and all. So this is what we have been supporting industries, academic centers, academic institutes, for what they want to do. And we have been requesting and supporting them for what we require them to. So both ways, the flow is there. And very recently, AICT has approved 1 M.Tech course in defense technology. We worked out what is required. See, today the manpower that is required immediately that can get into the defense production or defense research, that kind of manpower is not available in the country. So students do B.Tech or M.Tech in electrical engineering or electronics and communication and telecommunication, things like that, or mechanical engineering. When they go to the industry, they are not actually fit for doing the work that is required to be done immediately. So maybe for 6 months, 1 year, they are on rotation, they are on training, and after that only they become available for doing the work that industry requires them to do or DRDO requires them to do. So 1 year is a very long time. It is actually wastage of our manpower. So we have worked out a course, M.Tech in defense technology, and some of the subjects can be taken as electives in B.Tech as well. And this has been approved by AICT, and the UGC affiliated universities can launch it themselves because they don't require any approval from AICT because the course is already there on the website. And this will enable the students tomorrow to either get into the defense PSUs or the defense private industry, or to enable them to open their own startups. Because it is not that everything has to be done by big industries. The defense also has certain areas which startups can actually take up and that they can do a good job. And we facilitate PhD scholars and B.Tech students who work in our labs for a month or for 2 months or 1 semester. And in the M.Tech, in defense technology course, in fact, 2 semesters, we are saying that they can work in our laboratories along with our scientists to get fully trained in whatever areas that they want to work in. And we have outreach to small and medium industries and also the startups through a directorate called Directorate of Technology Development Fund. And the director of this directorate is already with us. She will be talking more in detail about what is done in this. So I will just add this only. So various technology readiness levels. So if it is 1 and 2 basic research, this is what is through the extramural research or the research boards, then taking it to TRL level 4, where development is required. This is what we do with our advanced technology centers in IITs and other universities. And then demonstration and making the systems and operationalizing those systems is done by DRDO. So this is the way how we operate. And these are, I think, time is going up, so I'll just cut short. Various kind of subjects that we deal with in various research boards. That if your university is also interested, probably you can think about it, and we will be willing to work together in these areas. And directed research framework, I already told a little more in detail. So this also maybe I will skip. Today have these centers available to us. So this is the center that we have at IIT Delhi, Joint Advanced Technology Center, and which is specializing in these five verticals. A lot of research work is happening and a lot of good things have come out of this. We have a center at Coimbatore to focus on biological activities, to support our biological, the life sciences cluster. We have a lab at the center at IIT Madras, which is specializing in these three areas, and also at Jadavpur University in Kolkata and Jammu University, look after the activities that are listed here, also at IIC Bangalore, Mizoram University, Hyderabad University. Like that, we are spread all over the country, north to south and east to west, and wherever, whatever is possible to do, wherever the university is specializing in certain areas or IIT is having expertise in certain areas, and we have the requirement, we want to work together and get the technologies forward. So a lot of good work has been done by these institutes, and you can see already see some work being done by some success stories that I have shown here, mimicking the fingers, for example, or making the test bed for fiber laser components at RIC Chennai, various kind of systems, fault tolerant and trusted platform. This will go into the human in space program. Those kind of activities are being done. Single crystals are being grown. And similarly, at IIT Delhi, a lot of good work has been done in terahertz imaging, terahertz transmitter and receivers, measurement setup, etc. Fabric coating, this is for the BPJ, is the bulletproof jacket. And we have certain ways of synergizing with academia, startups and industry. And I have already told well in detail how do we work together. Now, this is little more. I thought I'll put this one slide to you because you are in university. We also have PhD students, 500 PhD students sponsored by MHRD, Ministry of Education, Higher Education. We are supporting them, those 500 researchers, to work in our laboratories. As and when they come to us, we will put them in the laboratories, the correct laboratories for that, so that they can do the advanced work that is possible to do only in the laboratories that we have. So far, 42 institutes we have supported, and the students have gone to 28 laboratories, and as more and more will come, we'll put them in more and more universities. And this is the M.Tech and B.Tech course in the six streams, M.Tech course that we are, it has been approved, and some of the universities have come forward already to start this work, this course in the next semester. Combat engineering, aerospace technology, naval technology, communication technology, directed energy technology, and high energy materials. And the subjects that will be taught here can also be taken as electives in various courses that we found here. So these are some of the references that if some of you want further details, you can go into these references and you will get more details, or you can get in touch with the people who are managing these kind of activities, whether it is transfer of technology or technology development fund, patents, development, production partner, testing, proof and field firing, evaluation and certification. And if there is a requirement of export, and if there is a requirement of any technological support, scientific support for handholding, etc., we can give all that to all our trustees. Surat is a very special city in many ways, but some of the strengths that I could see is the textile industry, medical equipment, component accessories, and diamond processing. So I just put down the lab's names here. Maybe those who are interested, the fabric, the textile for parachutes is required by ADRD Agra. They can get in touch with the director there. And fabric for bulletproof jacket is required by DMSRD Kanpur. So again, can get in touch. And also by IIT Delhi. So Mr. Rahman is the contact point there. People can get in touch with him. Medical equipment at our lab, Debel in Bangalore. So his ID is there. And diamond processing requires laser machines. And we have the technology for high power lasers. So those who want to make the machines, they can get in touch with Director Chess, Hyderabad. Careers in DRDO for students, for graduate engineers and MSc and above, we do induct people at scientist B level and they can go up to scientist H level, which is a flexible complementation. If they do good work, they can reach the position where I am today. The startups are supported up to 1 crore and Director TDF will give more details in this. Students can also enroll in MTech in defense technology course, and after absorbing the technology, they can have their own industry, startups, etc. For diploma in engineering and BSc people, we induct at senior technical assistant level, and they also become group A officer after completing 5 to 7 years. And thereafter, if they do good work, they can rise in the ladder. And for ITI and equivalent, we take them as induction level, that is the tradesmen. But more than getting into DRDO, definitely you should aim for doing good research and all. I would suggest the young minds. It is always good, and I think many of the young minds are now preferring to open their own startups. So why not you have your own startup and do some good work and make the country proud. So thank you. With that, maybe I have overshot my time, but I think that was important for me to expose to what we do and how the industry and the academia can get benefited by the teams that we have. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your address on this very important subject. We have witnessed how DRDO support and promote Indian industries with DRDO developed technologies and also enhance their technical capabilities to become globally competitive. Truly, DRDO has been a torchbearer of the defense research and development in the country. In the era of every time is wartime, you have made us proud by showing the journey of our country in defense sector and how we have promoted and shown the world Atmanirbhar Bharat in this area. That was truly an informative session for all the students of our university. Thank you once again. Now, taking the program forward, I request Mrs. Preeti Namdev to introduce our guest of honor and speaker, Mrs. Niti Bansal. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. I am very pleased to introduce second speaker, Mrs. Nidhi Bansal, ma'am. Mrs. Nidhi Bansal, ma'am, scientist at G level, is the director of Technology Development Fund, DRDO headquarters. She is an aeronautical engineer and university gold medalist from Punjab University and pursued her master's from IAESC Bangalore in mechanical engineering. She has vast experience in the field of thermal engineering, computational fluid dynamics. She has worked on many projects on sonar system design and laser system design. She has many awards and publications to her merit. She took over as Director of Technology Development Fund in March 2020. And she is instrumental in extending support to MSMEs and DRDO startups through DRDO. We would love to hear from you, ma'am. Please, ma'am. Nidhi ma'am.
Nidhi Bansal, ma'am.
Yeah, I think
ma'am,
there is some issue with my connection.
Your voice is breaking, ma'am. Any issue?
Okay, ma'am, we can share.
Ma'am, take your time, no issue at all. Nidhi ma'am, any help you need from our side?
Am I?
Yes, ma'am.
Pardon, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
नहीं पड़ेगा ना कोई यहाँ पे प्रश्न
She's having some issue with the connection there. She's coming to my place and probably it'll take a couple of minutes. Is it okay?
Presentation. Yes, ma'am.
Pooja, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
So Nidhi is having some problem from
okay.
where she was talking. So she's coming to my place. Take a couple
okay.
of minutes.
Hello.
Okay, so we will wait for her.
Correct.
Okay, sir. Asha ma'am.
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Yes, Pooja.
Asha ma'am, we have to wait for 5 to 10 minutes as Nidhi ma'am is having some issue regarding net connection and presentation.
Okay, then we'll have to wait because Pankaj sir is going to have concluding remarks. That is possible only after a second speech. So we'll have to wait.
Okay, ma'am.
Meanwhile, if
any
Jainesh,
other update,
can you Jainesh? Pooja ma'am, can we have a video of our BMU? Meanwhile,
ma'am, that is with Jainesh, sir. He is the only person
he is there.
Who is able to present BMU video.
Okay, I'll talk to him.
Jainesh sir,
haan.
If you are having video of Bhagwan Mahavir University, can you just play it for us?
Okay, ma'am, wait a minute.
Yes, sir, thank you so much. So, meanwhile, we are having some network issue from our speaker's side. Let us have a brief introduction, a virtual tour of our university, Bhagwan Mahavir University.
Nidhi ma'am, is it okay now?
Yes, ma'am. Your screen is visible as well as your voice is audible.
Right. Thank you, and sorry for this network issue that I faced right at the time when I needed to speak. My greetings to Dr. Nirmal Sharma, Mrs. Asha Ram Narayana, Dr. Nomeshwar Yadav, Dr. Jay Joshi, Dr. Hitesh, Dr. Sanjay, and all other panelists. Thank you for giving me this opportunity where I could talk about this unique scheme that DRDO has launched on behalf of Ministry of Defense, where we are trying to engage with small businesses, the MSMEs, and the startups, give a boost to the economy of the country, and also to make the country self-reliant, Atmanirbhar, and also at the time, also at the same time, giving opportunities to these small businesses. So I'll in next 10 minutes or so, I'll tell you about the salience of the scheme, and if there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer those. The technology development scheme, like I said, is a scheme. The Ministry of Defense, which is being Defense Research and Development Organization. Under this scheme, what we're trying to do is we try to collate the requirements from the Ministry of Defense components like Navy, Air Force, Army. This could also come from DRDO or from our defense production units. Anybody who has any requirement, they can pass it on to us. We collate those requirements. It could be something which is be indigenized. It is until now, which is a component or a sub-assembly, or a whole assembly, something which is futuristic. So we look at both the areas, something that is we missed during the years, and something that will make us capable. So once we create those requirements, the requirements and that is too possible. The industry is successful in giving technology, they are for use as and sell it to the user or
Nidhi ma'am, or defense. Sorry to interrupt you. Ma'am, your voice is not perfectly audible. Well, can you please say in that manner?
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Sorry to interrupt you. Yes, ma'am. Sorry to interrupt you. Your voice is not perfectly audible. It's cracking sometimes.
Voice is breaking.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I think there are some network issues, Pooja. Is it better now?
Yes, ma'am. It is better now. Please continue. Sorry once again.
So I keep my video off. I keep you off. Yeah, off. Keep my video off. That we have better bandwidth. So this scheme is rather new. It was launched in 2016 by the then Honorable RM. And the idea was that we should be able to do this Make in India, these two issues of the government it tried to promote. The government again. Am I not audible again? Hello.
Yes,
the idea is to create a system for enhancing cutting edge technology so that the by inculcating the R&D culture in industry, so that tomorrow, if there are comments from the industry themselves can take it up and give the systems that are required, which are made in India. The salience of the scheme is that the fund is limited to maximum of scheming or maximum land share. 90% whole thing is funded by DRDO as a grant in aid. We look at the projects which can be turned around in 2 years' time so that the technology that we are trying to develop remain relevant. We, like I said, we allow collaboration between the research institutions, and even two or three industries can get together and give us a solution. The only criteria for any industry to participate in this is that they should have they should be controlled and owned by Indian citizens. Minimum of 51% share should be owned by the resident here. Now, what are the good things about the scheme for the industry is that they are joint holder of the IPR with the DRDO. They give a direct channel of sales opportunity to defense and also to the civil market. With the prior approval and due approvals, they can also export these better technologies. They also get chances to license the product and technologies for their commercial gains. And they they are the players who are ensuring the life cycle support and maintenance of this technology. Now, what the process flow that in the TDF scheme, the projects that we take, when we receive the requirements, we undertake the feasibility, and then we have a two-phase EOI, which is done, where we invite proposals from the industry as an open tender, and whichever industry, eligible industries, they come forward and give their expression of interest, we evaluate them, and the evaluated industries are given this grant. There is a, for any scheme to be successful, we need to do a lot of advanced planning and deliberations to see that the projects that we are taking are feasible to be taken in this scheme, so that there are lesser dropouts later. And like I said, that we do a lot of hand holding by the technical experts, a team of technical experts, and the user, that is the service headquarters. They all get together and handhold the industry to take it forward for the technology development. Now, for the startups, for the nascent startups, the startups which have just come out, the students which are trying to get into the startup field, we have targeted those students with the projects which are costing us less than 1 crore. So any project where the cost estimate is less than 1 crore, we are targeting the nascent startups. Nascent startups we are defining as the startups which are less than 3 years old and are incubated in a government funded or a government aided incubator. Basic idea is that we need to create a culture of engagement with innovative startups, and we want to empower the youth of the country so that we can encourage them to join the defense R&D, manufacturing and ecosystem, the way my director general was talking about a little earlier. So again, what are the criteria, eligibility criteria for the startups to join this initiative is that they should be recognized by DPIIT and should be less than 3 years old, the incorporation. They should also not have received any grants, any grant in aids under the Central Government of India scheme for a similar technology or the prototype development. They should also be incubated with the government assisted incubators, like I said, and the incubator should have supported at least 25 startups, out of which 5 numbers should be in the defense and aerospace arena for them to qualify for this. The clause of 51% control by the resident Indian citizen remains in this also. And any change of this, because startups is a dynamic area where you keep getting a lot of funding from various sources. So any change in this position, wherever the startup control is gone into foreign hands, I mean, less than 51% is by the Indian citizens, they have to inform us and we need to take proper action on that. What is this for startups to make the process faster? This two-phase EOI that was there in the bigger projects, we have shortened it to one phase so that the startups can come give their presentation and they give us a detailed project report as to what they are, how they're planning to do and how they'll take it forward. And based on the committee's decision, we will be able to award the projects to those startups. These are some of the evaluation criteria, largely how we are going to be evaluating the startups. And for us, in this criteria, if any startup is meeting more than 60% marks, we take them as shortlisted startups and we try to award them as per our process. What is the role of the incubator, you may ask, because the startups are nascent startups that we are looking at. They may not have the required infrastructure. They may also not have the required knowledge about this complete ecosystem, about what are the financial, legal, and other procedures that have to be followed. So we are looking at incubators to give them that kind of a handholding. And we are allowing a 20% share of whatever is the project cost as fees to the incubator. So, that is the role of the incubator scheme. But if there are any startups which are not less than three years, they'll be like established startups. They need not get incubated. And we will look at those startups. If we do not find a suitable nascent startup for our requirement, then this requirement will be open to the other startups as well. There is a small project mentoring and monitoring group formed by DRDO, which will have experts from the academia, from the industry, from legal and finance members would be there. There will be technical experts from DRDO. There will also be technical experts and user experts from the three services, which will support and mentor these startups whom we are taking and for the development of these technologies, which are required by the MOU. Our SOP is available on our TDF website. I will be giving you the link to that website towards the end of my presentation. There is once the startups or the MSMEs have finished developing the prototypes and they have been successfully tested by the user, the person who's given us the requirement, then the project would be taken as a project which would be which can be, the product can be bought under by IDTM category. This by IDTM category is a category which is defined by India government as the most preferred category. So when there is any procurement from the government, the first priority or the first the topmost priority is given to a category called by IGTM. So all the technologies which are being developed under this TTF would qualify for that. As I said, the IPR would be shared between the industry and the DRDO. There is another small scheme because I am talking to the students and the young professionals from the university. I think it will be my right place to talk about a scheme which DRDO has launched called Dare to Dream scheme. Here, it is a Pan India Innovation Contest where we are looking from entries from the innovators or the participation of the innovators, that is the individuals and the startups, against the requirements which we'll be putting up, which we generally do annually. We are going to be soon coming out with another version of this Dare to Dream. So you can apply against the requirements which will be there on in that Dare to Dream, and through proper selection of process, we will be announcing the award winners. The good idea about these award winners are that if their project is getting selected for this funding of TDF, they will be taken suo moto for the funding of the TDF. So it's a very, it's a golden opportunity for all your young professionals who would want to enter this into this arena to give to maybe wear your thinking caps and apply against the requirements that we are giving. Give us an innovative solution, and we'll take it forward with you through first through getting evaluating in the Dare to Dream, and if you found suitable, then we will also support you through TDF. So I think that is what I needed to speak to you. I'll be happy to interact if there are any questions. So my website, the TDF website, is tdf.drdo.gov.in, and Director General TM has already shared those details with you all, and we'll be happy to take this thing forward if there are any questions from there. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your very informative session. I'm sure our students have learned a lot of new areas and opportunities in this field. Thank you so much for inspiring and educating our students. Now we are going to start our question answer session with Shri Hari Babu Srivastav and Mrs. Nidhi Bansal, ma'am. Sir, may we have a question?
Please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Okay. One of the students of our university, Nimesh Dhamelia, wants to ask which degree is based for DRDO and what is the procedure for doing summer training in DRDO?
Okay, which degree is best is very difficult to say, because we are difficult to all areas, be it mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, electronics, civil engineering, IT, so chemical engineering. So you name it, we are working in that discipline. So it will not be correct for me to say which is the best degree. All people who are doing good work, who have good knowledge, we welcome them. Now, about doing the internship in DRDO labs, these days because of COVID, we are actually not really encouraging people to come because of this problem. But otherwise, you can write, you can see at the website drdo.gov.in. drdo.gov.in. So whatever clusters I talked about, they are all listed there. And under those clusters, what are the labs that are all listed? And what kind of activity happens in each of the labs, that is also listed. So if you look at the website, you will know which lab suits to your interest. And if you write to the director of that lab, they will be able to put you in that category. Every lab will have some way of doing, because there are every year large number of applications. It may not be possible for all these students to be taken because of the resources crunch. We will not have possibility to train, let's say, 200 people or 200 students in one lab, but definitely 50, 60, 70 or 80, depending on the size of lab, to take students. So you write to the lab and they will have some process to shortlist. You have to go through that. And I can only assure that if you are a genuine candidate, if you are having a genuine interest in technology, this generally is not a problem to get into the lab and do the internship.
Okay, sir.
Will that clarify your
question? Yeah. Yes, sir. Thank you. Now, next question is from Meenal. She is asking, how one should prepare for interview of DRDO department, means which kind of questions they have to prepare before appearing for the interview.
It is generally, as I said earlier, it is generally about the knowledge base that you have. We all look forward to having young, bright minds, ignited minds who work with us. It is not necessary that if I am making an aircraft, you should know everything about aircraft. It is not necessary, because you wouldn't have studied that. But if you say that I my favorite subject is, let us say, the aerodynamics, you should be able to answer the basic questions about the or basic technology about the aerodynamics, or for that matter, propulsion systems or whatever. So you should decide which is your expertise area, and in that expertise area, the experts who are sitting in the interview board, they will ask questions. Generally, we are trying to find out the knowledge that you have. It is not that we are trying to harass people and reject people. We are trying to find out the best people that we can take in our scheme, in our organization, and move forward in the technology. You would have seen that we all have to work at cutting edge. That if we don't do it tomorrow, somebody else will, the adversary will do it. We have to be one step ahead of the adversary. So that is where the race is between the technology holders, and the people who do the research. It should be passion for the subject, and you should be able to tell that this is my passion. And if you do well in that, generally it is win-win situation.
And that is the perfect answer. One should be passionate enough for the job. Yeah. Okay, sir. The next question is from Nikunj Gajera. He is asking, what are various modes of induction of scientists in DRDO system? Any experience required to be a scientist in DRDO?
Okay, there is no, if you are coming at the scientist B level, that is the induction level, there is no requirement of any experience. You hold a BTech degree or MTech degree or MSc degree. We have a center called the Recruitment and Assessment Center, RAC. They will be advertising whenever there is a vacancy. They will be advertising on the net as well as in the papers. And you have to fill the form. Depending on the number of vacancies and number of candidates, we may have written examination and interview process. So they will define all that process in the advertisement. And generally, it is not required.
Okay, sir.
But if you are trying for higher level, that is scientist C, D, E, F, and all, then naturally, depending on the position that you have,
obviously,
there will be some required. At induction level, there is one.
Okay, sir. One of the students of our university is asking, I am a research scholar. How can I know project sponsorship, scholarships, project grants, opportunities of DRDO?
So, as I said, we are actually not giving any scholarships to students. Okay. We are supporting the students who are supported by MHRD, Ministry of Education, Higher Education. If they are, if you are having a scholarship from them, we can support you in doing your research in our laboratories. So that is the mode. We don't give any scholarships for that matter. But it is one possibility that if you are working in one of the centers that we have at IITs or universities, let's say Gujarat University Center, we are working in. And if you are working in the area that we want you to work, or we want the university to work, then you may be in touch with the professor who is working for DRDO. And then from our project to him, he may give you a JRF or an SRF, or depending on the number of years that you are putting. So we directly don't give any scholarship, but through projects to advanced technology centers, the students can get into JRF, SRF mode, or we can support them in their research when they get the MHRD scholarship.
So this is it from our side. Thank you for answering students' questions very nicely. Once again, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now I would like to request Dr. Pankaj Gandhi, Associate Dean, Research Director, Bhagwan Mahavir University, for concluding remarks. Sir, please. Sir, you are not audible.
Oh, I am thankful to you for providing this opportunity to me to concluding the remarks of this particular webinar. It is really very interesting to interact with people like Dr. Srivastav and Dr. Nidhi ma'am. And this is, let me tell you, from the research perspective, this is going to open up some of the doors for our students to have the projects or some sort of work with the DRDO. And the way Srivastav sir has started that missiles were used in Mahabharat, that is what we all know, Brahmastras and other things. So also sir has very well pointed out that right now we are 100% sufficient as far as the missile technology is concerned. So that is what we can say, that the Make in India concept has been derived by DRDO. Sir has very well pointed out that change of the face of warfare techniques are being changing now. AI, ML and nanoscience, robotics and cyber securities are coming in this particular area. Sir has very well explained about the various clusters which are being available in DRDO for lab facilities. And I am also surprised by knowing the fact that 35 PhD students from various institutes are affiliated with DRDO for pursuing the research. So this is really a very good sign for our country. Now we can take help from them, and Goel sir is also over here, and our VC sir is also over here. We can move with some sort of syllabus. We can take help from them regarding the incorporation of some portions from DRDO side. And Nidhi ma'am has also very well explained about the licensing and other procedures. Now I would like to add to Srivastav sir for laser technology, sir. 80% of the laser machines of India are produced in Surat, which are being used in diamond cutting and polishing, and 70% of India's tent are cutting and polished in Surat, which are being made from seamless tubes of 316L and cobalt chromium. So these are the two basic technologies which are being developed by the local companies of Surat. And majority of the work is being done in South Gujarat for medical device development. Now, madam has given very well concept of project funding. So I am requesting all our faculties to take benefit of the same one. We can write to their project applications and other things so that our students can be benefited and we can move for the Startup India movement, right? This is, I am again thankful to Srivastav sir and Nidhi ma'am for sparing their valuable time to guide us. Certainly this going to be not final, but this is an initiative between Bhagwan Mahavir and DRDO. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to request Ms. Asha Dave ma'am, Head Corporate Affairs, Bhagwan Mahavir University, to present vote of thanks.
Thank you, Pooja ma'am. First of all, it's my pleasure to present the vote of thanks to a pride of our Bharat, that is DRDO. We are interruption. We are really proud of the jobs and different activities carried out by DRDO. The whole story started with a small request to mail to Dr. G. Satish Reddy, Chairman DRDO. And today we have this wonderful webinar. We are very thankful to Shri Habu Srivastavji. I have talked to you 2 times and I have found that you have been very cooperative to students, startups, and industry. Thanks a lot. We will always remember 3 lines of yours. Your address, I would like to repeat, is that Temple of Science, the building of DRDO in Delhi. Peace comes with strength, a dialogue by Dr. APJ Kalam, and our with our technology. Our war with our technology is the biggest thing which we are doing with the help of DRDO. Thankful to Nidhi ma'am. You have given a lot of information about funding scheme coming from the Chamber of Commerce of Surat and FICCI Ahmedabad, that I would definitely spread the share the video in my friend circle and hope that we come out. I know some of the companies who are making some parts of the tank as well as a pistol in, but we will come up with a big contribution to our Atmanirbhar Bharat. Thank you very much, ma'am. At this moment, I would like to thank the people behind the screen, Dr. Sanjay Pal and Chinkesh Kumar from DRDO, not seen in the screen, but they are managing the whole show, link and everything. And I forget our own BMU, our chair, Dr. Sanjay Jain, our provost, sir, Dr. Nirma, and the whole team of deans, directors, faculties, professors who are with me, and special thanks goes to our coordinator Dharmang and Suresh, and two madam who are moderating here, Preeti and Pooja. So the whole team, only a team can come out with such a wonderful things, and this is just a beginning. This is not the end, sir and ma'am. This is not the end. This is the beginning, and definitely Surat will be with DRDO, and one day we will hear that DRDO will be proud of Surat. Thank you very much. Over to Pooja.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And on that note, we are concluding our today's session with the permission of our honorable provost, sir.
Yeah, please. Sir and madam, thank you so much for joining us and giving a brief about DRDO. We are thankful to you. Let us hope we will have interaction with you in coming days, and we would like to start defense technology courses and other things in our university also with your help. So we'll be in touch with you. Asha madam will be in touch with you, and we'll be having meeting as and when the situation opens up. We'll be talking to you, and you can come here. We'll discuss, or rather we'll be going to you, and we'll be discussing on the projects and the issues, and we'll be implementing the things. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much, all of you. Professor Sharma, just for information, AICTE will conduct a webinar on 8th of this month, 8th July, to announce about this course of M.Tech, which I mentioned to you. So maybe you can join on that day.
And okay, sir.
More details will come out.
Sure.
Thank you very much. Thank you all of
you.
Thank you.
Once again, from Bhagwan Mavi University, I am very much thankful to all of you for joining this webinar. Have a great day. Stay safe. Preeti ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. I'm handing the papers.
Okay. Can you?
Yes, ma'am. I'm handing.
Okay.